The Mark C was a bigger car altogether. The extra space allowed the engine and front wheel to swing through 180 degrees, so the car could turn on its own length. Handy, because in order to drive the car on a motorcycle license, you weren't allowed a reverse gear. Having just left the Merchant Navy, Douglas Ferreira was in search of a new car.
I came ashore and immediately bought myself a new Bob Minicar, a brand new one at a Mark C. And I thought I'd take a holiday, so off I went abroad. And it was perhaps a mad thing to do, but I went down into Italy, down to Rome and Naples in January. And up to the Winter Olympics at Cortina, and then over passes which were officially closed, over into Austria, and all the way on to Vienna. It was cold, sort of minus 25 centigrade in Vienna, and for much of the way home. And the car did well. It did better than I did. I got severe toothache and frostbitten toes, and it was quite a trip. Eventually, Colonel Gray got to know about me and invited me to join the firm as their representative. Their one and only representative. It was just the sales manager and myself. But it meant that I had to visit all the agents for bonds, everywhere from Penzance to Wick, and out into Ireland eventually as well. And, of course, I had to travel in a Bob Minicar. I reckoned at one time I'd done about 300,000 miles in bonds. During the summer, especially with the hood down, it's extremely pleasant to have a small open car. And I just love it.
But Bond himself was not satisfied. He left the Minicar project soon after the Mark A to create many more weird and wonderful microcar designs. The post-war practice of make, do and mend continued with the introduction of a Bond-designed car you could build yourself. Brian Stevenson bought his Opperman Unicar in 1959. The cars were sold in kit form to avoid purchase tax.
It was less than half the cost of buying in ready builds because of the heavy purchase tax in those days. And also, it was a bit of a challenge. I didn't mind a challenge of that sort. I was fairly good at engineering, so that I didn't expect any problems. Problems came later. We had an awful job of getting it home. I had an argument with the railway company, so it stood in the sidings for nearly a fortnight while they found some way to deliver it. Eventually, when we got it home, the first thing we had to do was get it out of the box, which wasn't easy. It was a bit like a Meccano set, if you like. You just dug in the box and picked out the pieces. When it was all bolted up together, then we had to think about putting the doors on. And then we had the first tragedy. The hinges they supplied were, I think, probably off a Hillman Husky, and they were the bonnet hinges. So they wouldn't have all the way to the doors. The doors just snapped and fell off.
Despite the poor quality of the parts, it took Brian only 6 weeks to assemble the car.
Well, the first time out onto the road, I wasn't a bit happy with it. The steering was horrible. And it was then that I discovered there was a mistake in the manual. It said to tow the wheels in an eighth of an inch, instead of which you had to tow them out an eighth of an inch. So once I got that sorted out, it drove beautifully. Anywhere and everywhere. It was a workhorse rather than a pleasure car at the time. And having two young sons, we used to sit them in the back on these so-called seats. It's marvellous in a traffic lights Grand Prix. It's from 0 to 50, you could just about beat any car on the road at that time, and it looked like a motor car, whereas 9 out of 10 of the microcars rather looked like overblown three-wheelers, if you like, whereas this, it's a good-looking little car. For a small car, it's good-looking.
In the 3 years that the Opperman Unicar was available, only 200 were sold. Sadly, Brown's car no longer runs. Today, few British microcars are in working order. During the post-war microcar boom, manufacturers tended to combine bizarre body shapes with motorcycle engines in an attempt to get the microcar formula right, but most were downright disasters. This is the Allard Clipper. It was desperately simplistic, made from fiberglass and plywood salvaged from tea chests. The AC Petite was perhaps one of the most comfortable microcars, but it had a fundamental design fault. With different diameter wheels, no one knew which size to carry as a spare. By the late 1950s, microcar manufacturers were beginning to learn valuable lessons from the microcars they had produced too hastily or too shoddily in the past. The Frisky Sport was an improvement on most designs. Styled by Giovanni Michelotti, it was the one and only attempt to clothe a British microcar in a sharp Italian suit. Mike Webster has at last fulfilled his childhood dream of owning a Frisky.
This is the Frisky Sport. It's one of my newer acquisitions and a car that I first desired when I was 12 years old. It was in a book in this colour, and the book had Ferraris and every exotic car that you can imagine. But at 12 years old, it was the shape I fell in love with. So, a few years ago, when I started getting interested in these small cars, I set about trying to acquire one of these. It's quite unusual in that they didn't make very many, and it was a classic situation of an English design where they took an Italian designer to create a wonderful shape with a degree of impracticality in that it has no weather equipment that works like many cars of the 50s. It has no luggage carrying capacity, but it is a delight to own and drive.
Soon after he purchased the Frisky Sport, Mike Webster took his wife on an eventful trip to Holland.
We did have one or two little problems. She's now discovered what suicide doors mean. She'd heard the term but didn't understand it until we were going down a motorway at 50 miles an hour and this door came open. Needless to say, she wasn't terribly amused.